Penguin Random House Audio presents The Last Days of New Paris by China Miéville. Read for you by Ralph Lister. One overhears many reactions to surrealist art, but the most pathetic of all is from those who ask, "What am I supposed to see and feel from this?" In other words, what does Papa say I may think and feel about this? Grace Palethorpe on the importance of fantasy life. Chapter 1. 1950. A street in lamplight. Beyond a wall of ripped-up city, the Nazis were shooting. Past the barricade in a line of tailor's mannequins assembled in a crude and motionless can-can, Thibaut could see the khaki of scattering Wehrmacht men, grey dress uniforms, SS black, the blue of the Kriegsmarine, all lit up by the flares of weapons. Something sped along the Rue de Paradis, weaving in a howl of rubber between bodies and ruins, coming straight at the Germans. Two women on a tandem? They came very fast on big wheels. The soldiers shot, reloaded, and ran because the rushing vehicle did not turn or fall under their onslaught. There was a whir of chains. Only one woman rode, Thibaut made out. The other was a torso, jutted from the bicycle itself, its moving prow, a figurehead where handlebars should be. She was extruded from the metal. She pushed her arms backward, and they curled at the ends like coral. She stretched her neck and widened her eyes. Thibaut swallowed and tried to speak, and tried again and screamed, "It's the Velo!" At once his comrades came. They pressed against the big window and stared down into the city gloom. The amateur of velocipedes, lurching through Paris on her thick-spoked wheels, singing a song without words. "My God," Thibaut thought, because a woman was riding her, and that absolutely should not happen. But there she was, gripping the Velo's wrist with one hand, pulling with the other on leather strapped tight around the cycle centaur's throat. The Velo moved faster than any car or horse, any devil Thibaut had yet seen, swaying between the facades, dodging bullets. She tore through the last of the men and the line of figurines they'd arranged. She raised her front wheel and hit the barricade, mounted the meters of plaster, stone, bone, wood, and mortar that blocked the street. She rose. She hurled into the air above the soldiers, arced up, seeming to pause, falling at last through the invisible boundary between the 9th and 10th arrondissement. She landed hard on the surrealist side of the street. The Velo bounced and twisted on her tires, slid sideways. She came to a stop, looking up at the window of the Manor Plume's hideout, straight into Thibaut's eyes. He was first out of the room and down the splintering steps, almost falling from the doorway out into the darkening street. His heart shook him. The passenger was sprawled on the cobbles where her mount had bucked. The Velo reared above her on her hind wheel like a fighting horse. She swayed. She looked at Thibaut with pupilless eyes the same color as her skin. The manny flexed her thick arms and reached up to snap the cord around her neck and let it fall. She rocked in the wind. Thibaut's rifle dangled in his hands. At the edge of his vision, he saw Elise lob a grenade over the barricade in case the Germans were regrouping. The explosion made the ground and the barrier tremble, but Thibaut did not move. The Velo tipped forward, back onto both wheels. She accelerated toward him, but he made himself stay still. She bore down and her wheels were a burr. Adrenaline took him with the certainty of impact until, on a final instant too quick to see, she tilted and passed instead, so close to him that Thibaut's clothes were tugged in the rush of her air. Tire singing, the cycle presence wove between the shattered buildings of the Cité des Trévises, into ruins and shadows, out of sight. Thibault at last exhaled. When he could control his shaking, he turned to the passenger. He went to where she lay. The woman was dying. She'd been hammered by the German fire the Velo had ignored. Some fleeting influence at that powerful intersection of streets meant all the holes in her flesh were dry and puckered. But blood spilled from her mouth, as if insisting on one outlet. She coughed and tried to speak. "Did you see?" Elise was shouting. Thibault knelt and put his hand on the fallen woman's forehead. The partisans gathered.
"She was riding the Velo," Elise said. "What does that mean? How in hell did she control it?"
"Not well," said Virginie. The passenger's dark dress was dirty and ripped. Her scarf spread out on the road and framed her face. She furrowed her brow as if thoughtful, as if considering a problem. She was not much older than Thibault, he thought. She looked at him with urgent eyes.
It's,
she said. "I think that's English," he said quietly. Cedric stepped forward and tried to murmur prayers, and Virginie shoved him sharply away. The dying woman took Thibault's hand.
"Here,"
she whispered.
"He came. Wolf. Gang."
She gasped out little bursts. Thibault put his ear close to her mouth.
"Gerhard,"
she said.
"The doctor. The priest."
She was not looking at him anymore, Thibault realized, but past him, behind him. His skin itched in Paris's attention. He turned. Behind the windows of the nearest building, overlooking them, a slowly shifting universe of fetal globs and scratches unfolded. A morass of dark colors, vivid on a blacker dark. The shapes rattled. They tapped the glass. A Maniv storm had come from within the house to witness this woman's death. As everyone gathered, watched the black virtue behind the windows, Thibault felt the woman's fingers on his own. He gripped hers in turn. But she did not want a moment's last solicitude. She pried his hand open. She put something in it. Thibault felt and knew instantly that it was a playing card. When he turned back to her, the woman was dead. Thibault was loyal man à plume. He could not have said why he slipped the card into his pocket without letting his comrades see. On the stones under the woman's other hand, she'd written letters on the road with her index finger as a nib. Her nail was wet with black ink from somewhere, provided by the city in that final moment of her need. She had written two last words. Fall, rot. Now it's months later, and Thibault huddles in a Paris doorway, his hand in his pocket to hold that card again. Over his own clothes, he wears a woman's blue and gold pyjamas. The sky is screaming. Two Messerschmitts come in below the clouds, chased by hurricanes. Slates explode under British fire, and the planes tear out of their dives. One of the German aircraft coils suddenly back in a virtuoso maneuver with weapons blazing. And in a burning gust, an RAF plane unfolds in the air, opening like hands, like a blown kiss, fire descending, turning an unseen house below to dust. The other Messerschmitt veers toward the Seine. The roofs shake again, this time from below. Something comes up from inside Paris. A pale, tree-wide tendril, shaggy with bright foliage. It rises. Clutches of buds or fruit the size of human heads quiver. It blooms vastly above the skyline. The German pilot flies straight at the vivid flowers, as if smitten, plant drunk. He plunges for the vegetation. It spreads trembling leaves. The great vine whips up one last house height and takes the plane in its coils. It yanks it down below the roofs, into the streets, out of sight. There is no explosion. The snagged aircraft is just gone, into the deeps of the city. The other planes frantically disperse. Thibaut waits while they go. He lets his heart slow. When he sets his face and steps out at last, it is under a clean sky. Thibaut is 24, hard and thin and strong. His eyes move constantly as he keeps watch in all directions. He has the fretful aggression and the gritted teeth of the new Parisian. He keeps his hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.